So you may remember the Save the Internet movement. A lot of people associated with that movement are here in this room. They participated in it, they built it, and that includes Kiran, way back there. That includes Karthik, who sits on our board. And we put up this board, this post that TRI bans differential pricing, and we won. But the thing is that we have still not won, because actually measurement of technical discrimination is an issue which is still not resolved, and the TRI has put out a paper. So what I want to talk to you a little about today is that how policy change happens over a period of time. It has several blocks which are involved in it, which include the technical components, but also include research and then advocacy surrounding it. This is a medium-term project, and it requires stakeholder groups, such as people who build product, but also people who do research, and then people who do storytelling and influence larger culture. I'm going to take the case study of internet shutdowns, which has been in the news much more recently. You may ask, Apar, why are you doing this? And it's a completely different issue. And I do think they are different. But given that they're also similar, let me talk about how it actually is a bit similar to FOSS. And the thing is, the first is that it's an industry-wide issue, in the sense that it doesn't only impact your business particularly, it's impacting an entire sector by itself. When the internet is shut down, it's impacting too many companies who are building product beyond the telecom companies by itself, but we have not seen any individual startup say that it's impacting my business in a very, very bad way. It's the same thing with FOSS. Even though you do have a policy for government procurement, beyond that, there's a high degree of a lack of adoption, implementation around FOSS. The second thing is that it's driven out of a sense of political value. When I was hearing somebody talk about why they adopted a certain license, they said, we embraced it. So there's always a sense that you are aspirationally walking towards a certain choice you've made. And that's the same thing with internet shutdowns. When people say that the internet is actualizing a certain kind of freedom of speech and expression for them, for assembly, it is voiced with a certain degree of political value which goes beyond business. And finally, there's friction. There are a lot of interest vectors which limit you from achieving your goal. That internet shutdown should not be made, or FOSS should have a wide adoption by itself. They are prevailing practices in society. So I thought this is a useful framework to look, but at the same point of time, I do recognize the limitations and the distinguishing factors. And they are that substantively both issues are different, but this is a useful way also when you are distinct from something to have a distance from it, to look at it from a different perspective, to take the learnings from another area, which is also dealing with technology, trying to impact change, and you can look at learnings which have not been traditionally there with the free and open source community. And I acknowledge their efforts. They have done great work. They have done great community building, but there are ways and lessons we may learn from internet shutdowns as well. Secondly, internet shutdowns is a greenfield issue. It's come up in the last 2 to 3 years, and FOSS has been there for a long period of time. So what have actually happened with internet shutdowns of the past 2 or 3 years is can be capsuled and presented in a very, very neat package to you. And finally, the implementation itself, which is happening both of internet shutdowns as well as FOSS, is very, very different. I acknowledge the landscape is different, but again, the differences may help us look at both issues and take in learnings. Now, firstly, we have a judgment which has just come on 10th of January. It basically lays down certain standards when internet shutdowns can be made. It says three things. Internet shutdowns cannot be made without the orders themselves being published proactively by government, which is not a position in law, because the government was not disclosing this. And when you filed the RTI, it was not giving you the actual text of the orders. In fact, even in the Supreme Court, the government said we are not under any obligation to furnish these orders. And this is not only with the context of Kashmir. This is in context of all of India. And internet shutdowns are taking place everywhere. In fact, as per a popular tracker, the second highest number of internet shutdowns, if you would imagine, would be in which state, if anybody couldn't guess? No, second. Second highest. Yeah. But that count may be wrong. I may come to that also. That's because of lack of transparency by government itself. The second thing the court said was there's a legal standard of proportionality. You cannot shut down the internet in a state for all purposes and for all manners of time. And finally, it said that the underlying rules, the legislative framework, which allows government to shut down the internet, requires an urgent review. And till it happens, we are placing a 7-day limit. Every time the government passes an order to shut down the internet, it has to review it within a period of 7 days. And these rules are not cool. Now, in terms of the bad, the judgment said that, again, we are not going to judicially review the rules or the orders passed. They are not great, but it's the government's job. The status quo remains, and there's something which is very, very concerning. The court says that there can be selective filtering of what it calls as essential services away from social media services, and this threatens the public core of the internet. So you do have a bad outcome which is coming, and by no measure is this issue settled by going to court. So what are opportunities ahead? A future constitutional challenge? Should I think like a lawyer now and say that we will go back to court, win another day? And can the right to the internet itself be declared a fundamental right, given that it goes much beyond freedom of speech and expression, assembly? Today it in fact enables not only trade and profession, but may also in future determine very core facets of our day-to-day function. People may just not be able to access healthcare, and that's already happening. Now, what has been the large amount of evidence which has actually given basis to a lot of these arguments have been firstly numbers. Numbers are very important. Do numbers actually spell out the number of internet shutdowns and the type of and the extent of those shutdowns all over India? And that's a transparency issue. Now, as you look towards even FOSS and building opportunities, as your industry structure becomes much more mature, you should look at numbers. Numbers are powerful. And today, you are doing a conference which is exploring various startups in this sector which are adopting FOSS licenses. What is the total contribution? What is the total number? You do need to start counting it, because it matters in a policy conversation when you do it, that there's so many enterprises who are engaged in FOSS in India, this is their contribution, etc., etc. You need to be very clear about your methodology. You need to check for your biases, and you need to have a regular release cycle as well. And these are things which are already limitations in the pre-existing data sets. The second thing, the second kind of narrative which has been very strong has been the degree of economic loss which has been caused due to internet shutdowns in India. And you can invert it also. You can say, yes, when proprietary software is adopted, there is an opportunity loss. You can come out with a methodology in which certain kinds of innovation adoption are limited, but you can also frame it positively, that when you adopt a FOSS license, you downstream a certain level of innovation, and others can build upon it. And these numbers, again, are very powerful in policy conversations. They drive not only results in terms of review of policy, but they also drive it in terms of what the court actually holds eventually. Now, finally, what is also important is to recognize the social impacts of internet shutdowns. And there are three very good studies. One is basically narratives which have been built off interviews. The second looks at the feminists' impact, how internet shutdowns affect women. And the third is basically posing a counterintuitive result, in which it says that internet shutdowns actually prevent people from airing out their grievances. The pressure cooker example, where people can tweet instead of beating each other up on the street. And there's actually some limitation even in these kind of studies. They're geographically limited, they lack peer review, and they're peer referencing bottlenecks, so they don't refer to each other. However, over a period of time, I think all of this work will mature, because you're just seeing it over the past 2 to 3 years. Now, what are other research domains that I've skipped? There may be computing and networking and legal analysis. I think both of them can also be done. But I think computing and networking, if it's concentrated more towards, especially in terms of internet shutdown, in terms of filtering and division of services, it would threaten the public core of the internet. I would, in fact, prefer that the public core of the internet is strengthened, where the internet becomes a primary medium in which it bundles with electricity as well as other services with IoT, so you just can't turn it off and you can't filter it. So that's there. Finally, in terms of how does it actually help? Firstly, it helps in narrative control. All your public facing work, which is driven off emotion and passion, comes back to numbers. It comes back to evidence. You need to put it out. And it helps in storytelling. For instance, today, the story of the person who built the rescue website in Kerala, and around the Kerala flood, that's an excellent example of FOSS. But is it getting documented? Is it getting told? It is getting actually illustrated. Also, the much more successful companies which are being built around FOSS. This should become much wider in terms of public recognition and helps build an aspirational value beyond constituencies which already exist. Finally, international and local press outreach needs to improve, and this cannot be only be done by one or two trade bodies, one or two unions. It needs to be done much more widely. And that's why I think that partnership pragmatism is what's important, and which is what is sometimes lacking. We need to talk to different constituencies. Our key learnings in digital rights wins have been that when different constituencies focus on agreements, they can actually cause massive changes taking place in policy. When you can have civil society, segments of the private sector, as well as government agree on something, you can get work done. And that is possible when you look at what happened in Section 66A, as well as net neutrality. And there are entities in government, there are independent regulators which can look at it, which can look at even internet shutdowns. For instance, the TRAI can look at it. It may not, due to political sensitivity at present, but it does play a function there. Have we tried engaging with them? The National Economic Survey has a distinct chapter on data being extremely important. And I have a huge amount of difference with how they frame it. But it is recognizing the value of the internet itself. Wouldn't it be possible for us to get a singular comment from them with regard to the economic losses caused by internet shutdowns there? Similarly, there are opportunities there for FOSS, and that's the way I think this thinking should also be there, that we engage with government proactively with different bodies which are there to make sure that FOSS is reflective as an active demand and it is participated beyond one policy statement, one implementation framework of either the national of the union government and the state governments. Finally, we need to widen civil society groups which have not traditionally been there, because they actually, when they start using your products, they start building out on it, they actually recognize the value. And you're already doing that. I'm quite aware of that. So for instance, we at IFF have recently shifted from SurveyMonkey to block survey. We use Motic. We are trying more and more FOSS products, and we are interested in doing much more. Finally, institutional nudges, and how do you do them? So the Department of Telecom can be nudged. Parliament can be nudged. We have a standing committee of IT and electronics. Has anybody petitioned it recently? Has anybody asked it? Chitti to likhni padegi. And these are the kind of things one must start thinking, even in terms of positive engagement. If you want to maintain a government policy which is good and is benefiting you as well, you need to tell government it is benefiting you. Otherwise, there are interest groups which will claw back and will take it away. And finally, litigation. Incremental challenges need to be built through the high courts, especially with regard to internet shutdowns, right? You can't go for maximum. You can't say internet shutdowns by itself are illegal. The rules are illegal. You need to incrementally use all these frameworks of change and step towards litigation, because it's like going and putting all your chips on the table and gambling. So finally, These are set piece strategies. And this is what I always like to say in any of these decks, especially the policy decks. These are four corners and the world is outside it. And there's so much externality around it and there's so many moving pieces outside this deck by itself. And you can't control them. But this gives you a level of forcibility to a certain degree. This helps you even the odds. And this is a framework I hope that people in FOSS are also able to apply and learn, given that internet shutdowns by itself is an issue which is going to be there for some time. And a very clear instance of us doing all of this work collectively, different organizations, different individuals in internet shutdowns, recognizing these challenges, doing all this work, is that, and not wanting to go to courts immediately, is this. Only yesterday, somebody filed a PIL to challenge everything. And you can't control that. And as put by Calvin and Hobbes, if you can't control your peanut butter, you can't expect to control your life. So internet shutdowns, I may not know how this PIL may succeed or not, but the work will continue. So what I would finally like to say and end this short talk with, this work continues. That's in the nature of any digital rights policy issue. It's not like you win completely. I started out with net neutrality. We're still working on that. Just like you keep building product, please also think about tech policy as a product. So if code is law, then policy is also a product and it'll keep getting better. Things may be bad, but I think with the support and partnership of people who are here, a lot of whom are IFF members, there's an IFF co-founder who's no longer there with us. There are people who have supported us in different ways, helped build us a back end. I think these things are possible. Thank you so much.
You mentioned about identifying internet as a fundamental right.
Yes.
In some one of the slides. So there was a like verdict by the Kerala High Court saying that internet is a fundamental right.
Yes.
So isn't it enforceable?
So the technical answer to that, High Court judgments are only enforceable within the territorial limits of that High Court by itself. The High Courts are classically understood to be distinct branches as much as they do fall within the institutional hierarchy of the Supreme Court being an appellate bench, but have original jurisdiction over writ matters. Now, that rule of internet being a fundamental right applies within the territorial extent of that High Court, and it was not noticed by the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, in fact, states that we are not declaring right to the internet itself as a fundamental right, and we know our court likes to declare rights such as the right to sleep as well, which is a very important right. But yeah, more seriously, it links right to the internet to pre-existing fundamental rights, which are textually there in Article 19(1)(a), which is the right to freedom of speech and expression, and the right to trade and business. In fact, it does not, to my disappointment, even link it to the right to free movement and assembly. And another thing, these arguments were made in court, and we as IFF, we assisted two parties there as well. We were lawyers for them. We didn't do it to the maximum extent because you want to build cases sometimes incrementally. As much as I'm saying that code is law and policy is product, it's also applied skill. It depends on the situation you are in. So you don't want to overclaim knowing very well that you won't get it because you set precedent. If you set precedent and you lose, right, then you don't only impact that case, but you impact future cases as well. And in public interest matters, when you overclaim and you lose, it doesn't only impact you as a private litigant, but the entire public interest itself. So you have to do these things with care and with a certain level of incrementalism.
Thank you. Thank you for being there in the forefront of the fight.
Everyone is there in the forefront of this fight.
Apar, thanks for the bringing out internet shutdown. So my question to you was regarding the popular website you talked about. Could you elaborate which is a popular website?
Internetshutdowns.in, and I credited it up.
Yeah,
there.
Thanks. So that is a free software organization which is called Software Freedom Law Center, which supports the internet shutdown, and that's based out of India. And they have a whole map of all the shutdowns in the country. you could, and it's all based on open source. Anybody could contribute to that. Thank you.
And I would also like to recognize internetshutdowns.in. It's been a valuable resource for a lot of people, and I hope their work continues and it gains greater strength. All the best to you, man.
Hey, thank you for the talk. And I have an answer to the question that you asked about Kerala Rescue and the documentation. So there is a documentation done by the community, but I agree that it has to be publicized better. And more importantly, I have a question for you. It's regarding net neutrality. So in my home back in Kerala, I have a railway broadband provider. So they actually partner with Google to provide free internet to a lot of railway stations. So they are also giving service to home customers. So I have observed that the Google websites bandwidth, the speed of the Google websites are like 10 times faster than the rest of the stuff. So there's the net neutrality violation right there.
Is that a CDN?
No.
It's due to a CDN or? It's
no. They are enforcing a limit on the rest of them.
Oh, they are?
Yes.
Yeah, and here's the problem. There's no technical monitoring of ISPs. And the underlying problem, and I'll just be candid here, is because the underlying market structure is becoming a duopoly more and more. Right? So you may reach a state of a single provider market by itself. So in the absence of competition, your choice as a both as a user but also on the business side gets impacted. And this undermines the principle of net neutrality. So that's why not only stronger regulation by itself, but also monitoring mechanisms and enforcement frameworks need to be there, which actually work, right? And this is what the TRAI has brought out a recent consultation about. And it's taking comments till 30th of January. It's a very good paper, in fact. It has a substantial amount of comment which actually thanks civil society for being there, which given today's climate, I was kind of surprised. But it's there. And you don't need to reply very, very technically. You can just say this is important. We support your role as TRAI. And these kind of enforcement frameworks need to be done as soon as possible. So it's going to be a technical measurement which will be devised by, they're still looking at what are they calling a multi-stakeholder group, which will compose of telecom companies, people from the internet companies, academics, technical experts, and what they call as civil society advocates. Yeah, and they have proposed various models for it. One part of the job will be standard setting, that what should be the reasonable disclosure by an ISP for network practices which are followed. And the second will be actually violations which will be monitored, and then recommendations will be made to what is the central government authority, the Department of Telecom, to enforce it as a license condition breach with the ISP, because every company which provides you with a telecom service is an internet service provider. It is bound by certain rules, which are called the unified access licenses, which are now having net neutrality protections. The problem is the monitoring and enforcement. And right now, that is being formed on the basis of a consultation by TRAI. So please do participate.
Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. So I just wanted to talk about like the internet shutdowns which is happening in India. So a year before I was traveling in Rajasthan and I figured out my mobile internet was not working. When I tried to find out the reason, it was because you know there was an exam being conducted and they wanted to stop malpractice.
Yeah, and even the admit cards for that exam were actually digital. So people, it's meta. It's meta level problem. So the people who are actually supposed to give the exam got an SMS 2 days in advance ke internet nahi chalega, apna admit card aap please download kar lijiye phone pe ya print kar dijiye internet se.
So that's kind of like you know crazy. So do you think like is there a way like we as the people here like at least like we have some knowledge about like this should not be happening. So is there a way we should be like, you know, educating the public, you know, that this must not be the case. This is like your kind of your fundamental right. So is there a method or is there a program which Internet Foundation or Internet Freedom Foundation is like doing right now to educate common public about these things?
I think there are several organizations who are doing work in this area, sizable work in this area. Our work is only one of many. So we do use social media widely. We ran a campaign in 2016 called keepusonline.in. It had an explainer video what internet shutdowns were back in that day. And it did have certain amounts of signups, etc. What I do think is that the strategy play, if you're looking just in terms of getting positive statements on internet shutdowns, you need to start at a lower level rather than right now directly at the union level. And you also need to widen the number of participants who voice it. Usually it's civil society actors who actually lack a high degree of power and they are not even given a seat on the table. So I think what would be useful is two opportunities I identified. One is the National Economic Survey. If people do know people who are in the economics domain, people who are past contributors, and you can take out previous National Economic Survey reports, who are people who are writing it, especially from the private sector who you may know, to creep in a comment there about internet shutdowns. Or secondly, ask TRAI by itself to look at it. You can by yourself also do other things, such as asking state governments municipalities or your local MLA to make statements against them. This will all be useful because what we have seen is that internet shutdowns are a political issue, but they're a non-partisan issue. All political parties like it, okay? And I'm not saying this as a quote-unquote centrist. The evidence quite clearly indicates that. RTI responses which we have received, as well as internet shutdowns.in, as well as Access Now's tracker, as well as Facebook, which measures it technically, all show that it's been imposed across political dispensations because it's been imbibed in a way by the administrative apparatus of a state, which doesn't usually change. When they seize a power, they don't usually give it back. So that's, I think that's the way to go about this more, to make it a much more popular issue and to talk about it more.
Thank you.
Thanks, Apar. I greatly appreciate, personally, IFF's work. You guys are doing great. I don't have a question, but I just want to urge everyone here to check out the Internet Freedom Foundation. Without open and highly available internet, there's no FOSS, there's no point in running a conference or sharing code. So this is a much more fundamental and philosophical issue too, of course, a political one. So please check out their website, please try and understand the work IFF is doing. And as developers, as FOSS enthusiasts, I think we maybe even have some sort of an ethical obligation to stand behind the work. That's just my observation. I just wanted to add that. Thanks.
Thank you so much. I deeply appreciate that coming from you.
Hi. See, there is always a two side of a coin, right? So one side we are talking about internet shutdown. Another side, government may think, right? Because even in Twitter, people tweets a lot and then, it fires up. There could be chances of riots. Government may think in another direction,
Definitely. Right?
So there is always another side of the story.
So the other side of the argument is the argument in terms of prevention, precaution, and lives being more important than the internet itself. And the second order argument to this, which is made, is that of national security by itself, where certain regions by themselves carry a certain degree of history in terms of loss of life. Okay, yeah. So fairly acknowledging both arguments by itself, I would say that the first argument with respect to safety itself has been to a certain degree addressed, and I'll just give you references by social injury. So if you just look at this tab, and if you can take a picture by your smartphone, you may find some of the answers here. Okay, and I don't want to repeat what other researchers have actually done through actual field work.
Hi. So I just want to ask about there was this particular piece of conversation when the Kashmir internet shutdown case was being heard. So there was there was Justice Gawai and Advocate Mehta. So the conversation was about WhatsApp and Telegram. So
and dark web.
Yeah, yeah.
Every judicial conversation is about dark.
Yeah. So Mehta claimed that Telegram is more secure than WhatsApp, which is technically inaccurate because WhatsApp has end-to-end encryption and Telegram doesn't. But then how do you go about explaining technical concepts to probably a judge who is not well-versed with technical...
You don't. That's why I agree with Anivar. When he says lawyers should come last, I say judges shouldn't even be here. Okay, so and there's a reason to it. I'll tell you why. Because these are technical product level decisions, and I think institutional capacity needs to be built where you can do it much more in a balanced way, drawing from evidence if there is a need for regulation. The public interest litigation system is not geared towards number one evidence, ordinary evidence in terms of social injury. Leave aside technical evidence in which a judge is not trained to be even reading and perceiving as much as they may be learned as to technical points of data. So there's a limit to me even determining. And this has come across very clearly in the Madras High Court traceability case, in the Aadhaar social media linking case, where a government IIT professor says traceability can be done without breaking end-to-end encryption, and law enforcement can access messages in plain text and post three solution. And there's another expert in our intervention brief, and this is an independent opinion by Professor Manoj Prabhakaran from IIT Bombay, who heads encryption there, who's chairs there. And he says that no, it breaks the very fundamental purpose of end-to-end encryption if you can get the plain text within transmission by itself, right? So I would say that public interest litigation by itself has become a system which is somewhat unmanageable. It does still have its benefits, but it's very lopsided. We lack institutional capacity primarily to deal with what are the technical inputs and devise regulation in a manner which is much more reactive, and courts by themselves should not step in there. I take my comments back about all judges. So it's more of an institutional issue right now.
Hi, so my question is like, just now I was reading a tweet that in Kashmir, rather than allowing all internet, they have allowed 153 distinct websites.
Yeah.
So, and on top
of it- A whitelist.
Yeah. On top of it, what I feel as a regular user is, rather than blocking websites by giving the name themselves, government does play with the internet infrastructure, like they manage the CDNs or the DNS. Sometimes they'll randomly block the HTTP websites, but not the secure ones. And whenever I try to contact the ISPs, they don't give a clear-cut answer ever.
Yeah, and part of it has to do with the license conditions. Part of it has to do with the environment we work in and the rule of law framework. So there's a great joke which kind of puts it in a capsule. An American says that my country is great, I have a free speech protection, I can go outside the White House and say that my president is an idiot. The Russian says that, hey, even my country is great, I can go outside the Kremlin and say that the American president is an idiot. So it all comes back to the rule of law. And you may have a theoretical you may have a theoretical protection of freedom of speech in both constitutions, which is there. In the USSR constitution, there was a protection on free expression. But if you don't have a rule of law environment, businesses can't speak up beyond a degree. So you have to do it a bit more tactically. I do not sympathize with ISPs beyond a point also, because they have not even incrementally pushed the barrier on the kind of issues which needed to be represented in the interest of their users or even in their own self-interest beyond a point. So yeah, ISPs are secretive. the entire basis of censorship built in India, from site blocking to website to complete internet shutdowns, is built of secrecy, and it's actually due to the law, but that law has also not gotten challenged, and ISPs, to their part, have not seen it as a very big issue till now, which it has become. Thank you so much.